sponsoring this demonstration with the Chilean Human Rights Alliance. They are also with us. And we have many other organizers and activists from all over the city here to talk today about the coup happening in Bolivia against the democratically elected Evo Morales government. The indigenous and working people of Bolivia have risen up against this coup that's being sponsored by the imperialist nations, including Canada and the US. And we're here to say no more! No more! Hands off Bolivia!
We're three of the singers from St. Kateri Tekawisa Catholic Parish. It's the indigenous Catholic parish of Winnipeg. Actually, it's one of the very few indigenous Catholic parishes anywhere in North America. And as I was explaining to our dear sister Leslie Spillett, it's our church, okay? This is Norma, who's a Cree woman. This is Sister Tung, who's a Vietnamese woman. And I'm Cheryl Ann, and I'm a Métis woman from here. And you can cheer for that, because I'm from here. We wanted to do a song. I have had a love for the Bolivian people, I think, most of my life. When I was a child, I had the opportunity to know Father Joliker, who was from La Brocri, but whose family is just still right across the river here in St. Boniface. He became a professor and went to Bolivia to teach at the university. He supported the leftist students, the poor in their justice struggle for decades. He was murdered in Bolivia, where the right-wing people who shot him dead in his bed set his house on fire in the hopes of covering up their crime. No one has been brought to justice for this yet. He was an oblate. The oblates were the ones that helped us start our Kateri church. One of the oblates was Father Nicanor, who came from Peru, who was a student of Father Joliker's. These people, although I know we have a struggle with the Catholic Church, these particular people spoke to me always of justice and of solidarity with each other. Not from the top down and telling people what to do, but from living with people at their roots and learning from them. Our indigenous struggles, whether they be First Nations struggles, Métis struggles, Inuit struggles, whoever struggles in this country that they've created, are not different than the struggles of the indigenous people throughout the Americas and around the world. Or anybody who is working and looking for justice. We're going to sing a traveling song. We're singing the Ojibwe traveling song. And it's not just for funerals. But it is about supporting each other on our walk. Being beside each other and lifting each other up as we walk along. We walk in a circle, but we're not going backwards. Bolivia didn't take a step backwards. This is just a step in their spiral up and up and up. And we are singing to that circular spiral of our collective walk in the world. This is the Ojibwe travel song.
Just in case you can't be heard.
Way ahead.
you. We love Bolivia. Our next speaker is with the Chilean Human Rights Alliance.
Yes.
And they will be speaking now. Their name is
Laura Castillo.
Laura Castillo. Please welcome Laura.
Good afternoon, everyone. I just want to start off by thanking everyone who took the time to come out here today to support not just Chile, but also Bolivia and Venezuela, and in general, to support and to stand up for the human rights violations that are currently occurring in South America. So I'm going to start off with just a few words to talk about what the situation in Chile is at the moment. Right now, we as Chilean people living abroad, specifically in Canada, are here because we would like to be the voice of those who started off and who suffered human rights violations back in 1973 with the dictatorship of Pinochet. With the support of international pressure and different countries, we were able to put that pressure and finally abolish that dictatorship, and we were promised that a better life of dignity would come to us as people, as people who are part, or who are human. Now, unfortunately, it has been 30 years, and in those 30 years, our people are still suffering human rights violations. We are not, or they are not, living a life of dignity. They are suffering. They do not have anything to eat. They're barely making it to the end of the month. We don't have a good, secure, and healthcare system that would allow everyone to have an equal right and an opportunity to live past 40, 45, or 50. People are dying in their beds. People are dying in the corridors of the hospitals. And some people are even being turned away. Our parents and our grandparents are dying because they don't have enough food, they don't have medication, and they don't have the option to stand up and say, we need more. So the young people, the newer generations, have decided to step up and become part of the voice of those that cannot keep fighting. And that brings us to where we are today. The people in Chile have decided to stand up against these violations, and they have taken to the streets fighting for the rights. And we, as Chileans, living abroad, are also supporting our people in Chile, and it is very important, and I thank you all again for being here today, because that's what we're doing. We are placing international pressure, and we are letting people know that what is happening in Chile needs to be heard. Unfortunately, up to this moment, all I've seen on the news are maybe 30 seconds of a few people on the streets throwing rocks. That is not the problem. The problem is that the government is not listening to us. The problem is that the Canadian government, one of the leading countries in human rights issues, has not made themselves present in our country. So I speak to you today as a friend, as a member of Canadian society, and I say, let's stand up. Let's stand up for all the people in South America. Let's stand up as a voice of pressure, of international pressure, to make sure that human rights issues are no longer violated, and that all the people that have hurt our children and our generations, that have taken out their eyes, that have murdered them, that are currently being tortured, that are being raped, that those people who have hurt them do not go unpunished. Because it's been over 30 years that we have gone without anyone being accountable for the things and the violations that have happened since 1973. This needs to stop, and this needs to stop now. So I leave you with these last words. Yesterday, the government of Chile decided to finally say, yes, we are going to make a new constitution. And for many people, this has been great. It's good news. However, we cannot stop there, because this new constitution is going to be made up of all the people who are already in government, who are corrupt. That's right. It is a band-aid situation to a much larger society situation that is affecting everyone. It doesn't stop here. They want us to stop complaining. They want us to stop going to the streets. But we cannot stop here. We need to make sure that everyone is accountable, that the people that are going to be in government are, and the new constitution is made up of people, not just from political parties, because that's maybe 30% of the of people that are represented in the whole country. But the other 70% of people are not being represented because the 70% of people that don't go out and vote don't have anyone who, they don't feel that anyone can represent them right now. So we need to make sure that whoever is going to take part in writing this new constitution are people from the unions, people from the streets, from different organizations and associations, so that the people are heard. We have a few more events that we will be scheduling, and we are hoping that everyone will come out. Please invite your friends, your families, supporters, associations, union groups, everybody. We need to spread the word, and we need to continue being the people of Canada who are leading human rights issues in the world. Thank you very much.
Next, we have organizer Leslie Spillett. Please welcome Leslie.
So bonjour. I honor the ancestors of this territory and the descendants that are still here. We're still here. I want to send my love to the people of Bolivia and the people of Venezuela, and wherever peace and justice loving people exist, I send my love to them today. About maybe 8 years ago, when the commissioners gathered in Ottawa to share the final report of the Truth and Reconciliation Commission, in the audience was the Minister of Decolonization from Bolivia. And I thought, hell yeah, Canada needs a minister of decolonization. And instead, we got ministers of colonization from the last government and from every previous government that we've had in this territory. You know, I do know that this an indigenous-led anti-capitalist movement is actually the only hope that we have for lasting peace and for a world that we can all live in a just way in. An anti-capitalist and indigenous-led movement is what's required. That is the example of our relatives in the South, and they will continue to be an example. You cannot kill a people's revolution. You cannot kill people's dreams of justice and equality and liberation. Never will that die. And the other thing that I love about Bolivia and the indigenous peoples movement is the church is not in some house, it's on this earth. This earth is our church, and the sooner that we begin to understand that we're all on this planet, and that we, instead of worshiping money and greed and all of those things that are a part of colonialism and patriarchy and capitalism, the sooner that we will come to a place of peace, and that this earth can continue to sustain us. So this earth is our church. We have to really understand that. I want to thank our organizers, our beautiful sister relative that have come together, that have brought us together today. And just never give up. You know, Indigenous people are still on this land. We were supposed to be exterminated or assimilated, and here we are. So we never give up. We got to rise up. We got to stand up, and we got to keep going. This is This is our destiny together. So, miigwech.
We are so extremely lucky and honored to have Leah Gazan here to speak today. Please give her a warm welcome.
Hello, everybody. I want to thank the organizers. I'm here to stand in solidarity with Venezuela, Bolivia, and Chile today. It's time that we join together and start a movement to fight against a growing corporate dictatorship that puts profits before human rights, that puts profits before fundamental indigenous human rights. And that will take us all joining together as a united force. I'm pleased to stand here as a member of Parliament for Winnipeg Centre to tell you that I am ready to stand strong in the face of social injustice and human rights violations. I will not stay silent. But I need all of you. We put too much stake in individual politicians. But the power is with the people. So I am asking you to join me, to guide me in our unified struggle to achieve human rights for all. Thank you very much.
All power to the people.
All power to the people.
More speakers, but I'm going to try to buy some time before one gets here, because I still really want her to speak. But I think it's time for a little bit of background on the coup. I'm sure we all know what's going on, but for the purposes of the demonstration and mass education, we want to give a rundown of what's going on right now. On Sunday, following his October re-election, President of Bolivia, Evo Morales, was forced to resign after threats from the nation's military, police forces, and violent right-wing protesters. The opposition forces, made up of Bolivia's wealthy capitalist elite, burned and ransacked the homes of members of Morales' party, assaulted supporters of the president, and kidnapped and assaulted a Bolivian mayor. These attacks were also racist and colonial in nature, targeting the indigenous peoples of Bolivia, who make up the majority of Bolivians, and who elected and continue to support Morales. Opposition protesters were seen publicly burning the indigenous Wafala flag and physically attacking indigenous women wearing traditional regalia. Shame! Janine Anez, the opposition senator who has since sworn herself in as interim president after Morales was given political asylum in Mexico, has repeatedly expressed her own profoundly colonial and racist views on indigenous and mestizo peoples in Bolivia, who make up a 68% majority of Bolivians. This is a clear coup against Bolivia's democratically elected indigenous and socialist president, an attack on the indigenous and working class majority in Bolivia, who overwhelmingly support Morales and who have made tremendous social gains under Morales' socialist government. The economic policies of Morales' government, particularly the nationalization of large sections of the economy and its industries, have funded social initiatives that increased access to education, raising literacy rates, and drastically reducing poverty. The opposition coup leaders made up of Bolivia's wealthy elite seek to undo these social and economic gains for Bolivia's indigenous and working class majority and to open up Bolivia's land and resources to privatization and profit for the descended capitalist class of Bolivia as well as their imperialist backers. Shame! Although the coup is being carried out directly by the reactionary capitalists that make up the opposition supporters, police, and military, the primary role of Canadian and U.S. imperialism in orchestrating this coup can never be ignored. Well before the orchestration of the coup, a familiar narrative emerged in the imperialist media. The Organization of American States claimed the re-election of Evo Morales was fraudulent, fueling the anti-government protests. These claims have been proven baseless. Members of the U.S. and Canadian governments have since expressed support for the coup and for the fascist opposition. The U.S. and Canada have much to gain by orchestrating this coup and installing a right-wing government willing to serve the economic interests of capital. The opposition seeks to destroy the economic reforms established under the Morales government for the benefit of the majority of Bolivians by reprivatizing the economy and opening up Bolivia's natural resources for capitalist plunder and exploitation. This is a colonial imperialist attack on the national sovereignty of Bolivia, its government, and its indigenous and working class majority. Shame.
Shame!
But this coup is not over. The indigenous and working peoples of Bolivia are rising up against the colonial imperialist coup, against the right-wing opposition's threats to national sovereignty, and against the theft and exploitation of their land and resources.
The people united will never be defeated.
All over the world, indigenous and working class people and organizations are standing in solidarity with Bolivia against the coup. Countries like Mexico, Cuba, Syria, Argentina, Paraguay, Venezuela, and Nicaragua, and all peoples and nations throughout South America are standing with the majority of Bolivians and calling for the coup to be dismantled. Here in Canada, we stand on stolen indigenous land, occupied by the settler colonial Canadian state. Indigenous peoples here and in Bolivia know better than anyone the brutal crimes of colonialism and imperialism throughout history that continue today. The resistance of indigenous peoples here and in Bolivia show us the inseparability of Canadian and U.S. colonialism at home and abroad. The eruption of organized resistance by indigenous and working peoples in Canada, South America, and throughout the global South has been an inspiration to all of us organizing here in the Imperialist Center. They remind us that the struggle for self-determination is a global struggle, and that through struggle we will win. Next, we're going to hear from Radhika Desai.
Thank you. Woo! Yes, it's a very good one. Thank you, everyone, for turning out. I think this is a fantastic turnout. Thank you. I think we are showing people that there are people, we are showing the world that there are people in Winnipeg who understand what's going on around the world and what's wrong with it. Friends, Latin America is on fire. Latin America is on fire and the flames are burning greater than ever. Let this be the beginning of us setting light to all of the Americas, to English America, to French America, and all the other Americas, because the rights of the indigenous people and the ordinary people of these countries should never have been denied. And we have come to the point where I think they can no longer be denied. Latin America underwent a very long night of authoritarianism, disappearances, fascism, you name it. All of this was done in the 80s and the 90s. Slowly, since that time, popular power has been asserting itself. It has taken the form of the governments, not only of Cuba, which was for a long time the only progressive country in that hemisphere, in that continent, but also Venezuela, Ecuador, Argentina, Brazil, and many, many other such countries. It was called the Pink Tide. And these governments began to turn the balance of power, which was for so long weighted in favor of capitalists, of mining interests, of imperialists, of people who destroyed the environment and peoples right, left, and center. They slowly began to change this balance of power and weigh it in favor of ordinary people, of indigenous people, and so on. And Bolivia, for long, was the shining light of this, as has Venezuela been. And what we have just witnessed is the attempt to turn the clock back. The same attempt, by the way, we have been told by the American government that it is also going to target Cuba, Nicaragua, and Venezuela. The fact of the matter is that these governments represent the beginning of the end of imperialist and capitalist privilege in these countries. And that is why imperial power is going to do everything it can to stop it. But remember, people who are united, who are aware, who are willing and able to defend their interests cannot be turned back so easily. They can turn back this government or that, but people's power will reassert itself. It has just done so in Argentina, and it will do so in many other places. And we, ordinary people in Canada, in other imperialist countries, we need to join our own struggles for better wages, working conditions, better social services, and increasingly ecological integrity. All these struggles have to be matched with the struggles going on in these far poorer countries. And we have to join hands and join shoulders in order to contest the power of the capitalists and the imperialists. So let this be only the beginning. Thank you.
Okay, I think now we are going to open it up so that people who have come here can come up and speak if they'd like to. So if you want to speak, step right up.
El pueblo unido jamás será vencido. El pueblo unido jamás será vencido. I'm Andy Taylor from the Communist Party of Canada. The second oldest party in Canada. There's been a shameful spectacle from Ottawa, from all three parties represented nationally. The Conservatives, the Liberals, and the NDP have been shamelessly silent or making mixed up, confused signals about the coup in Bolivia. On behalf of the Communist Party of Canada, with its dedication to the scientific understanding of world revolution, we condemn outright the fascist coup perpetrated by the CIA and by the local bourgeoisie in Bolivia. And we say, down with the coup! Our members in Winnipeg, just in our club here, represent the heroic Chilean Communist Party, represent the Communist Party of Colombia, represent the Communist Party of Uruguay, and I'll say again, the Communist Party of Chile. Let's hear it for the Communist Party of Chile. We represent the Communist Party of India, the Communist Party of India, Marxist, Leninist, and we represent most of all, the cause of the lifting of the burden of private property and the bourgeoisie off the backs of the world's working class. One lesson I'll end with. In Bolivia, as in Venezuela, heroic strides were made, but there was one thing left that fatally undermined the revolutions, and that was what? They were both capitalist countries where the majority of the means of production were owned by private business, and so there was continually sort of a beast lurking within the house. You cannot, you will never trust the national army unless it's a revolutionary army. You will not, and you can never have socialism while you are a capitalist country. Yes, the government is socialist. They made great strides, but private business was there. Where do they go? They go to the American embassy. The big mining corporations, the people who want the world's lithium, the people who represent the owning class. And so this is a lesson. Elected governments, social democratic governments can be overturned very suddenly. It happened in Bolivia. People woke up and it was a shock. Private ownership of the means of production is an enemy of the people. Long live the cause of freedom, equality, common ownership of the means of production, and long live Evo en masse. Thank you.
Okay, the mic is open. Hands up, Bolivia. Hands up, Venezuela.
From 2000 to 2005, the working class and the poor in Bolivia waged incredible struggles. We shouldn't forget that. They rose up. They overthrew government after government, driving out Carlos Mesa and the other neoliberals. And so that's what brought the mass to power. We mustn't forget that Evo Morales and the mass came to power because of incredible struggles and incredible sacrifices that the people of Bolivia made earlier in this century. And the mass brought in and has brought in all sorts of important social reforms that have improved the lives of people in Bolivia. They've struck a blow against the deep-seated racism, right? This is a majority indigenous country that's long oppressed the indigenous majority. And it's because of those changes that the right hates the mass so much. And that's because of those changes that they have been targeted for this coup. And as my comrade said before I went up here, we should always remember the only good coup is the band that Boots Riley was involved in. But the demands of those struggles that brought the mass to power were far more radical than what they were actually able to deliver. But the hope for that kind of far-reaching change still remains in Bolivia. And against this struggle against the coup, right? In the struggle against the coup lies the hope of reigniting those struggles, of reigniting the agenda for left indigenous liberation and taking it forward. The coup against the government of 11 ministers, including four fascists, has to win. Any progress in Bolivia is only going to be possible with the defeat of this coup. So we have to do everything we can to talk about this to people in Canada. We need to bring this up in our unions, in our community organizations. We have to explain to people that it really is a coup and that the federal government of this country is arm in arm with the coup regime. We've got to make it really clear. We have to condemn the federal government with its talk of human rights, with its talk of reconciliation that denies them in practice both here and around the world, and extend a hand of solidarity to those people in Bolivia who want to reignite the struggles for liberation and take them forward.
El pueblo, el pueblo, el pueblo, ¿dónde está? El pueblo está en la calle gritando libertad. El pueblo, el pueblo, el pueblo, ¿dónde está? El pueblo está en la calle pidiendo libertad.
grande, caramba. El pueblo unido jamás será vencido. El pueblo unido jamás será vencido. ¡Cantar! ¡Vamos, vamos! ¡Nah!
The people are sad and angry and disheartened, but there is hope if we keep organizing and if there is solidarity and we stand, we stand.
Oh, I would like to invite the Chilean people to sing our national song.
One in front of the Millennium Library, one in front of the MTS Center before the hockey game. We'll be wearing eye patches and we'll have some pictures of the dead. And if you want to bring banners, flags, pots, and pans, you're all welcome. It's from 5 to 6, between 5 and 6. And if we all want to meet in front of the Millennium, and then we'll split up into two groups, or we can switch it up, whatever. Just to let people know, spread the word. There is an invite, event invite on Facebook that I've sent it out to a few people, so please spread it. Let everybody know that it's happening. It's next Saturday between 5 and 6. Thank you.